We begin in the U.S., which may see its AAA credit rating cut by Fitch Ratings on the debt limit impasse. Fitch says the rating watch negative reflects increased political partisanship that's hindering reaching a resolution to raise or suspend the debt limit despite the fast-approaching X date. Although the ratings agency did say it still expected a resolution to the debt limit before June 1, at which the government runs out of cash. U.S. Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen reiterating a catastrophic default could come in early June if the $31.4 trillion debt ceiling isn't raised. The reminder comes after another round of inconclusive meetings between negotiators for President Joe Biden and Republican House Speaker Kevin McCarthy. Unfortunately, no deal came out of the four-hour meeting at the White House on Wednesday, at least not yet. The Biden administration tells Republicans preventing a default is not a concession.
Well, first of all, let me tell the American public, I am not going to give up. We're not going to default. We're going to solve this problem. I will stay with it until we can get it done. But let's be honest about this. We have to spend less than we spent last year. It is not my fault that the Democrats cannot give up on their spending.
House Speaker McCarthy, meanwhile, still confident they will get to an agreement in time, but stands firm any deal on the debt limit must come with spending cuts. ANC's parent firm ABS-CBN had its annual stockholders meeting this morning. Our correspondent Jackie Pasquale covered that, and he joins us live for the latest. Hi, Jackie. Anything new?
Hi, good morning, Michelle. ABS-CBN held its annual stockholders meeting with company president Carlos Katigbak, saying that ABS-CBN will continue to seek partners as it eyes a bigger audience market than before. Katigbak said the company continues to look for more partners to produce the best programs in all platforms globally, whether on free TV, ATV, or online streaming. He asserted that ABS-CBN will focus on being a storyteller. He also told stockholders that he hopes the company will regain profitability in the near future, saying it will be an uphill climb to profitability. But it has shed off assets that are no longer needed, generating 3 billion pesos income from the sale of properties, which helped offset financing costs. Katigbak clarified that there is no deal yet on the redevelopment of the ABS-CBN compound, which circulated online. Revenues are up to 19.2 billion pesos in 2022 from 17.8 billion in 2021. Net loss decreased to 2.6 billion in 2022 from 5.6 billion the previous year. Katigbak also thanks their partners, audiences, employees, and stockholders for the continued trust and support as ABS-CBN eyes to establish itself in the global arena as one of the top storytelling companies. And that's the latest. Back to you, Mimi.
Jackie, just a few questions. Number one, did they ever give a timeline for when ABS-CBN will be back in the green?
No, Mimi. They just said that Carlos Katigbak mentioned that it will be an uphill climb to profitability, and they hope to regain profitability, quote, unquote, in the near future.
All right. And just to clarify, no final word yet on who will be redeveloping the main building of ABS-CBN, which is where the newsroom is actually located. But has the property been sold?
Mimi, one stockholder asked that question, if what's the plan or what is the final details of the redevelopment of the ABS-CBN compound. Katigbak said that there is no final deal yet. As of now, there's no project or any the redevelopment plan for the compound for now.
All right. Of course, this ASM comes on the heels of the announcement that Teleradio will stop operating by the end of next month. Jackie Pasquale there. Thank you so much for joining us, Jackie, for the updates from that ASM. Globe Telecom's venture capital unit Kickstart is planning to launch its fourth fund, which could just be its biggest yet, to finance more startups in transportation and agriculture over the next 10 years. Kickstart Ventures president Minette Navarrete said the fund could be double the amount of its latest portfolio. It could also not be. She adds the amount will depend on the startup's demand for new funding. Among areas. The key areas of focus for investments will be offline to online models, mobility solutions, food security, and technology to help address climate change. Kickstart was launched in 2012 to support the Philippine startup ecosystem and has so far made at least 39 investments in digital companies. It now manages two funds for Globe and advises the $180 million Ayala Corporation Technology Innovation Venture Fund. The Philippine Tourism Department set to double the number of tourist-rest areas in the country this year. The so-called tourist-rest areas, one of the flagship programs of Secretary Cristina Frasco, are centers that will house coffee shops, pasalubong centers, comfort rooms, and tourist information areas in key spots across the country. There are currently 10. These are located in provinces like Ilocos Norte, Baguio, Cebu, Palawan, Bohol, Samal Island, and Bukidnon. The agency says a number of local government units and two big private enterprises have already expressed interest to partner with them to build the projects. The DOT is also ramping up its travel incentive program called Bisita, Be My Guest, which gives Filipinos who invite foreign tourists to the country a chance to win special prizes. The country, as we know, is targeting 4.8 million foreign tourist arrivals this year. It has so far hit 1 million in the first quarter already. Bohol Island is nominated as the first Philippine site on UNESCO's list of global geoparks. The list recognizes areas that combine conservation with sustainable development. The UN Cultural Agency highlighted Bohol's scenic and varied landforms and structural features where it said traces of the island's subterranean past can be found. It also hailed Bohol's diverse flora and fauna, which conserved endemic species. The popular tourist destination, along with 17 other sites, will soon join the Global Geoparks Network, bringing the total number of members to 195 this year. Asia-Pacific's economic growth seemed to become more uneven this year. The APEC policy support unit citing higher living costs as one of the factors they're slowing down economic recovery efforts post-pandemic. It points out income levels have not recovered to pre-pandemic levels in most APEC economies, resulting in widening inequality. The APEC policy support unit forecasts the region's GDP to expand slightly to 3.1% this year. Growth is expected to slow down to 2.8% next year. To prevent a slumping economy, the group calls on APEC countries to strengthen their cooperation, to encourage inclusive dialogue and concerted efforts to achieve their growth objectives. The Philippine State Grid operator on the defensive after earning the ire of senators over its unfinished projects. The National Grid Corporation of the Philippines says the projects were delayed due to restrictions posed by the COVID pandemic and right-of-way issues. In Wednesday's Senate probe, the Energy Regulatory Commission said 33 NGCP projects in Luzon, 19 in Visayas, and 14 in Mindanao all remain unfinished.
COVID happened. That's the reality. Okay. Right-of-way happened. It's a problem. Even government admitted that right-of-way is a difficulty. When asked if it was better for government to handle a right-of-way, I said, you know, if they can do it, that's great. But the problem is, in actuality, the right-of-way that government turned over to us in 2009, up to date, has not been fully settled. We actually have people, landowners from the 70s, complaining they have not been paid. And the difference between government and NGCP is that when we enter, we have to pay the proper compensation to the landowners. That doesn't seem to have been the case because they have not turned us all, the vast majority of our right-of-way has no documentation. And that poses a problem for us because the people are angry at us, thinking that it is us who owe them, when actually it was government who entered.
Outdated and overused electrical equipment seen as one of the culprits behind a recent power outage that led to travel chaos at Manila's International Airport. Vivian Gulia reports.
Transportation Undersecretary Roberto Lim says NAIA3's outdated electrical equipment has exceeded its life expectancy. Amid this, a short circuit is seen to be one of the causes of the power outage last May 1st. This was among the preliminary findings of the interagency committee investigating the incident. The findings were disclosed in Wednesday's resumption of a House panel probe.
The preliminary findings on May 1 indicate that the outdated electrical equipment in NAIA Terminal 3 is already beyond its life expectancy. From point of construction, it is more than 20 years old.
Lim adds the interagency body also identified weaknesses in AEA3's technical manpower and inadequacies in its tools and equipment. The terminal has only 2 electrical engineers and 27 technicians who have limited competencies to conduct maintenance of high-voltage equipment. To address this, tech personnel will undergo training and upskilling, and the Manila International Airport Authority is looking to outsource to a third party the operation and maintenance of the AEA's high-voltage equipment. MIA officer in charge Brian Co told the House panel they are already finalizing the terms of reference and the target is to get it published next month. Some lawmakers, however, raised concerns.
The quickest way that we can ensure coverage is to get po a third-party O&M to manage our high-voltage equipment. But we agree po that we need, of course, we need our in-house capabilities to improve as well. Kaya po ang mga personnel natin ngayon, pinapadala natin sa necessary trainings para po mag-upskill.
Why would you consider outsourcing it when in fact, yung agency na maka-hire ninyo na mag-outsource, pwede niyang isabotahe yun?
There is a TOR that is being prepared for the selection of this third party. And part of that would be the eligibility of the candidates. Number two would be their track record. Next would be generally they are well-established names when it comes to undertaking these activities.
Another challenge seen by the interagency committee is the failure of NAIA3's contractor Takenaka to turn over to the government NAIA3's as-built plans, which would have guided MIA in the preventive maintenance of the terminal.
How can we have a comprehensive audit without the presence of the as-built plan, sir? They're totally blind on the system of Terminal 3.
But the DOTR assured lawmakers it has communicated with and secured commitment from Takenaka regarding the turnover of NAIA3's construction sketches, plans and drawings expected to arrive next week. On the possibility that the power outage was caused by deliberate acts or negligence, Lim says the committee is still investigating the matter. But MIA says it has already beefed up security in NAIA's power source generator and vital facilities with additional fixed guards, CCTV cameras, and roving personnel.
We would say that there is a weakness in the protocols and the procedures adopted in place, but not amounting to negligence because, you know, the processes, the procedures are that is available to them.
The interagency committee is expected to come up with updated findings on the first week of June. Vivian Gulia, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Information and Communications Department wants robotics to be included in the elementary school curriculum. They admit there is no budget for this right now, but they're hoping that local government units can find the money to make it happen. Jackie Pascual reports.
Of course, we have the King Mayor.
Singapore-based robotics learning center Null Space has entered the Philippine market with a new branch in Taguig. It will initially offer 2 programs for 9 to 14-year-old kids. One involving programming within the popular sandbox game Minecraft, the other involving robotics programming using Legos. It's all about learning through play.
It's very interesting. There's many things you can do it.
Null Space Philippines wants to replicate the program's success in Singapore. It wants Filipino kids to get a head start in robotics and computer programming. Even the Department of Information and Communications Technology wants to include robotics and computer programming in the elementary school curriculum.
Robots, that will trigger more interest with the kids. So it's a form of learning that it will excite them, but the knowledge itself, they can be applied in many different forms.
Ang importante is makuha natin yung awareness at saka yung interest ng mga bata as early as 9 years old para magkaroon ng mas marami tayong professionals pagdating sa technology sector.
DICT is now discussing this with the Education Department. But for now, it is urging local government units to take the lead. Valenzuela City has done just that. It will soon hold a free robotics summer boot camp.
They're aware of Minecraft. They're aware of Lego. But hindi nila alam on the there is such programs like coding. Bago pa ito sa masa.
Aside from helping children gain knowledge and new skills, officials say these classes can also lead to high-quality jobs in the future. They note that even now, demand for workers with these skills is very high.
It's a shortage, I think, globally. Here in the Philippines, same. You know, it will take you like at least 2 to 3 months to hire one dev. You know, so the companies are really struggling in terms of hiring these kind of talents.
Coding at saka robotics are the foundation of everything that we do. AI, for example, hot na hot ngayon yan.
They hope robotics and computer programming will be part of the daily lives of young Filipinos, stressing that workers with these skills will help drive economic growth moving forward. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.